Okay, we come to the part of the scripture, but we're going to skip over Hebrews. We're not going to do Hebrews today. Sorry, Janice, for doing all that extra work, but I think we're just going to concentrate on the Luke passage, and that'll make things a little bit shorter. Now, if I had to include the Hebrews, I'd have to preach longer, so I think you'll appreciate it that I don't do that. All right, so but if you're looking for a common theme between the two of them, it's worship. It's worship. All right, Luke chapter 13, 10 through 17. Now, Jesus was teaching in one of the synagogues on the Sabbath. And just then, there appeared a woman with a spirit that had crippled her for 18 years. She was bent over and was quite unable to stand up straight. When Jesus saw her, he called her over and said, "Woman, you are set free from your ailment." When he laid his hands on her, immediately she stood up straight and began praising God. But the leader of the synagogue, indignant because Jesus had cured on the Sabbath, kept saying to the crowd, "There are 6 days on which work ought to be done. Come on those days and be cured, not on the Sabbath." But the Lord answered him and said, "You hypocrites, does not each of you on the Sabbath untie his ox or his donkey from the manger and lead it away to give it water? And ought not this woman, a daughter of Abraham whom Satan has bound for 18 long years, be set free from this bondage on the Sabbath day?" When he said this, all his opponents were put to shame, and the entire crowd was rejoicing at all the wonderful things that he was doing. Okay, so I gotta get my pages here, right? So, get the scene. Jesus is teaching. He in the synagogue. It's on the Sabbath day. Yes, I'll see you. See? Okay, then the scripture says that the woman had a spirit that had crippled her for 18 years. She appears. Jesus sees this woman bent over and declares that she is set free from her ailment. He then puts his hands on her and she stands up straight, freed from her ailment. Now, there's no indication that the woman came to be healed by Jesus. She probably came to the synagogue to hear the scriptures and the commentary on the scriptures. Maybe she just came to the synagogue on the Sabbath because, well, that's what you do on the Sabbath. And maybe she came to visit with her friends and her neighbors. Maybe the woman did not even think about why she was there. People have all kinds of reasons why they go to the synagogue on the Sabbath. We don't know this woman's reasons. Think about this woman, okay? She suffered pain and shame for 18 years. She was bent over for 18 years. She suffered physical pain, having her internal organs pushed together. You know, her lungs are scrunched together. Her heart is squeezed. And there's pressure on her stomach. She probably has trouble breathing. She gets tired easily. It's hard to eat. She probably has reflux. She has probably pinched nerves in her back. But her physical pain was probably minor to the emotional pain that she suffered. For 18 years, she's bent over. She has seen the ground around her feet wherever she went. She could not look up to anyone in the eye. People avoided her because people believed at that time that anyone who had a physical deformity or were ill, you know, were being punished for some sin that they had committed. Her life was miserable in a number of ways. Jesus doesn't even ask if she wants to be healed. He just does it. He lays his hands on her. She stands up straight immediately. And a whole world of possibilities now opens for this woman. Her physical pain is gone. Her heart, her lungs are free to function so much better. She can see people face to face. She can even look up to heaven. And people will no longer condemn her for being punished by God. Now, many of you know how an ailment and an injury can keep you down, hinder your freedom of movement, your freedom to be without pain, your freedom to socialize, freedom to work. But you get sick, you have no energy, you have no strength. You get injured and you cannot move. You have an ailment and you cannot have fellowship with people. Your own body becomes a prison, holding you down, crippling you. So when Jesus heals this woman, everyone realizes the tremendous blessing that she has received, right? And the whole congregation rejoices, shouting, "Hallelujah, praise God, amen," right? No. Jesus does not receive praise. He receives, you know, for what he's done, he's received criticism. The leader of the synagogue and others are indignant that Jesus cured this woman on the Sabbath. Well, how could he do that? You know, doesn't he have any sense of decorum? Jesus has performed work on a day of rest. Jesus has done a miracle when everyone should be thinking about God and how God has blessed us. How dare he do a blessing when we should be thinking about blessings? And how dare he perform a miracle when we should be thinking about God's miracles? Well, the leader of the synagogue tells Jesus that he should come back tomorrow, do his miracles. Jesus responds with indignation in return to the leader of the synagogue by telling him, "You hypocrites, does not each of you on the Sabbath untie an ox or your donkey from the manger and lead it away to give it water?" Jesus points out that everyone does something that could be considered work, but everyone accepts that meeting a need for a living thing is necessary. Of course you feed your livestock. Of course you give them water. In another place in the Gospels, Jesus says that if the donkey fell into a well, you know, on the Sabbath, wouldn't you work to get that donkey out of the well? You would save the donkey's life. Jesus has tried before to get people to understand that the Sabbath is not instituted to test us. It was commanded to help us. Jesus said to another group of critics that the Sabbath was made for people, not people for the Sabbath. The Sabbath was made for our benefit, not for God's judgment upon us. For people who worked sun up to sundown every day, they needed a day to rest, to recuperate. Otherwise, they would simply just work themselves to death. It is well known that people work better when they have times of rest. Workers are more productive when they get a coffee break. And when they have at least a day a week to rest, they do better. They're more productive. Sabbath was also instituted for us so that we would have time to reconnect with God. Hearing Scripture, hearing the comments on the Scripture, yes, people can become closer to God by praying to, by meditating on God. People can become closer to God in these ways, and being closer to God is for our benefit. God's not some egotist who needs our worship and adoration, but we need to worship God and to give God our worship and adoration. Our God, our worship of God is directly for our benefit. Worship of God reminds us that we didn't create the world. Worship of God reminds us that there is something greater than ourselves, that we are a part of, something greater than what we are. Worship of God reminds us that we're responsible and accountable to other people and to the one who created us. It's important we realize that we're not God. Somebody already has that job. We are God's employees. And God employs us to meet human need. That was what Jesus was trying to get across to the critics in the synagogue. He asked them a question which gets to the heart of the issue. Ought not this woman, a daughter of Abraham, whom Satan bound for 18 years, be set free from the bondage on the Sabbath day? Jesus is saying that this woman has a need that he could do something about. So why shouldn't he do something about it? Why wait one more day? This woman has suffered long enough, hasn't she? Why punish her for another day? Well, healing this woman on the Sabbath is more appropriate. To free someone from the grip of evil is a Sabbath experience. God is all about freeing us from enslavement to evil. And it is the very thing that God wants us to do as well. The Sabbath is meant to celebrate the freedom that God gives us. And what better way to celebrate that freedom than to free someone else from evil? Jesus' critics realize the hypocrisy of what they have done and the appropriateness of what Jesus has done. His critics are embarrassed. They're full of shame. Molly wants to preach. Okay. Amen. Thank you for the amen. Yes. They realize Jesus is right. And they do not understand why they did not see this from the very start. We get caught up in rules. We live by the letter of the law so often that we forget that there are things which are more important. We get so used to doing things a certain way that we forget why we do things this way and believe that it's the only way to do things. Why did Jesus' critics criticize him for doing a miracle on the Sabbath? What was the reason? I'm asking you, why? Broke a rule. What was the rule? Yeah, which one is that? It's the fourth commandment. You know you're in a UCC church. Yes. The fourth commandment, doing work on the Sabbath. So they considered doing a miracle doing work. So Jesus' critics, they wanted to obey God. They wanted to give God respect and honor. That was their intent. Their motives were honorable, but they were short-sighted. Breaking the rule to not work on the Sabbath in order to help someone else in need is the better way to give God respect and honor. The woman who had been bent over was not the only person who received healing that day. Jesus' critics also found healing of another sort. At least for that moment, they were healed of their narrow-mindedness and they became aware of the greater understanding of the worship of God. As so often happens, but we don't always realize it, Jesus does not simply heal us physically. Oftentimes, when someone is healed physically, they are also healed spiritually. And oftentimes, so do the people around him. Consider that even today, as we read or hear these stories of Jesus, we can find spiritual healing in hearing them, in reading it. That's what worship is all about, healing, that is. Oh, sure, we say that worship is about giving thanks and praise to God for all of our blessings. We think worship is all about what we give God. But the truth is that what we give God is what benefits us. Our worship of God is good for us. We get to reconnect with God. And if for at least a brief time during the week, we think about God and what God wants us to do. When we do the things that God wants us to do, we find internal peace and satisfaction. It's not only right to give God thanks and praise, it's good for us. We find spiritual health by being close to God, by being connected to God. We are all in need of healing of one kind or another, healing of many kinds, perhaps. We all have come here this morning, a little or a lot, bent over in the spirit. We have all some spiritual handicap or disability which we have carried with us. Oftentimes, that disability makes us only see the ground around our feet. Sometimes, we are unable to look up and see heaven because we are spiritually stooped over. Remember, Abraham Lincoln once said, "I can see how it might be possible for a man to look down on the earth and to be an atheist. But I cannot conceive how a man could look up into the heavens and say there is no God." Worship is about looking up. So we come to worship to find some healing. We come to worship to spiritually stand up straight and to look to heaven and to God. We are all in need of some healing from Jesus. And I pray that you will be set free in some way today. Amen.